Happy Wednesday. Welcome, welcome, welcome to another episode of Comic Convos Podcast. Today, we have a new special guest co-host with us. His name is Opa, and he's going to be telling you about a new company that he just launched, Flow Valet. Of course, Comic Convos happens each and every Wednesday, and we interview entrepreneurs, artists, and CEOs on their journeys. On their journeys to wealth, right? And so typically we have somebody that's working in their industry. And today, hey y'all, thanks for coming in. So go ahead and introduce yourself to our listeners and let them know who you are and what you do.
Hello everyone, how are you guys doing today? Happy Wednesday. My name's Okwe, I'm the CEO, I'm the founder of Flowville. We're primarily a wealth management, investment strategy, and business consulting firm. However, our services are very boutique, very bespoke. We primarily concentrate on the sports, creative, and entertainment industries. So we tailor strategies that are peculiar to this niche, and we just make sure that we're able to bridge the gaps between this industries and other industries in terms of corporate partnerships, endorsements, merchandising, product licensing, and also we're able to tailored strategies and investment opportunities that cater to the peculiarities of this industry. So primarily, that's what we're offering right now. We've got scaling plans. We eventually hope to scale into a bank and incorporate some 360 business consulting services.
How did you niche down to that particular area?
Well, I actually started my entrepreneurial journey from this industry. I primarily started in media, eventually pivoted to entertainment, and then also incorporated sports. So I did that for quite a number of years. I started doing that from my university days, I believe I might even say college days. In the early stages of my career, I primarily focused on those industries. However, as time went by, I gradually evolved and I happened to venture into so many other industries. I went primarily corporate. I did finance, asset management, wealth management. I've done real estate. I've worked in government. I've done manufacturing, supply chain, and I brokered deals, mergers, acquisitions. So, I just got to a point in my entrepreneurial journey where I decided I wanted to do things I was passionate about. And find a way to incorporate my experiences and my expertise over the years as well, and just find a unique standpoint where I can, bring all this together and offer something that's not necessarily readily available in the market. So that's how I got here.
Yeah, sounds good. Two points that you brought me to when you were just talking. You merged some of your knowledge that you had from your background, some of your corporate experience, and then you put together a niche that was needed in the market. The other thing I heard you say is, first of all, I want to ask you, and I'm sure the listeners want to know too, is where are you from? Because I know we hear that thick accent as well.
I'm Nigerian. I'm very much Nigerian.
Okay. Shout out to my Nigerian listeners, okay? Okay, so the other thing was, you mentioned wealth management, and of course, I own Carter Capital, which is the only 24-hour wealth development firm and institute. It is our number one sponsor of the show. And with wealth development, we particularly focus on the community and letting them know that there are different areas of wealth. It doesn't just mean like having a lot of money or things of that nature, or focusing on growth, such as savings accounts, CDs, college funds, Christmas clubs, focusing on working with credit unions versus banks, things of that nature, and just financial literacy and education. When it comes to asset and wealth management, can you kind of dive a little bit deeper into that? Because I know for me, this week I went to like a retirement seminar, and I was probably one of the youngest people in the room. And they were like wondering, like, why are you here trying to do wealth management at this age and stage? But not knowing my goal is to retire at 40. So can you kind of let the listeners know what is wealth and asset management?
For me personally, I would speak from my viewpoint and I would take this from my lens, because I think that's the only way I can give you a peculiar answer. For me, wealth management is really just ensuring that you're able to meet your personal goals. It's very personal. You know, what wealth management means to me is definitely different from what it means to you and the next person. So to some people, it might be stability. To some people, it might be creating some sort of avenue for abundance, you know, via investment. For some people, it might be legacy. You know, it might be estate planning, you know, passing it on to the next generation. So at the end of the day, it's quite self-explanatory. It's wealth, whatever wealth means to you. It could be a certain figure. It could be access to money readily available. It could be financial stability. It could be, you know, investment in multiple spheres and streams of income, whatever it means to you. And then obviously managing that and making sure that you're able to attain those personal goals as regards your financial and your goals when it comes to money.
What do you think a good age or stage in life do you think you should start doing wealth management?
I would say you should definitely have some strategies and techniques in place at every single point in your life. Obviously, you might have to ensure that you're at a stage where you want to take up a consultant or like a wealth management specialist or expert. You know, you definitely have to have some sort of allocation for that, right? But I would say that you definitely can start a personal journey once you start to earn any type of income. You know, you can start to do research yourself. You can start to find, you know, that these days there are books, there are, you know, layouts, frameworks that really work for everyone. So once you start to earn some sort of income, you can definitely start to find ways to personally manage your wealth, manage your finances. And then as time goes by, as you start to earn more, you would definitely know when you start to need some help and start to need some more informed decision making and some more, you know, expert advice and, you know, expert investment strategies. So,
what would be your top three wealth tips for anybody that's like just getting started or maybe made their first 100K or maybe saved their first 100K or hit like a milestone where it's time to do something different?
That's a very interesting question. I'm once again going to say from my own lens, because I don't want to say certain things and people say it was this guy that said that, you know. Once again, it's very personal, to be honest.
So we all speak from experience or, you know, things exactly that happen in our lives. So I've learned or something I've experienced.
Once again, I'm going to say it's very personal. You know, the irony is, if you asked me this question 6 months ago, a year ago, 2 years ago, I probably would have had different answers at every point in time, just to show you how personal I reckon this is. For me right now, I would say first things first is stability. You know, you want to make sure that you're stable. You want to make sure that your income is spread out in such a way that it takes care of your expenses and you're not under any financial pressure. I think that's the first step. You know, so once you're able to achieve that, you know, being able to map out your expenses versus your income, gradually you would have some sort of spillover. And then that's when you start to think investments. Some people would say savings. That's also personal to them. But then for me, my approach would tilt more towards investments first, in such a way that your money works for you, in such a way that your money is able to make you more. And then, you know, when you start to make things like passive income, residual income, then you can start to save. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because if you don't have investments, your savings are really just one mishappening or one unfortunate event away from being zapped. So for me, I would approach this from those three steps. You know, first thing is find stability, then start to find some sort of spillover, some sort of abundance that you can invest, obviously in the right things. Make sure you're careful about your investments. Make sure you're making informed decisions. You're using, you know, well-proven strategies. You have some sort of expert advice. Are you putting your money in the right places? And that way you start to build multiple streams of income, and then you can start to save some, you can start to reinvest some. And I think you're very much on your way to a life of wealth and abundance if you take those three approaches.
What would you say to someone who has done all of those things, right? And then they just fell in love or they made bad investments and they're trying to recoup and start all over with their wealth. What would be some recommendations that you would give to that person?
I would say I feel like we've all been there. It's part of the process, it's part of the journey. There's some mistakes you just have to make yourself. You know, there's some parts of the process that you really can cheat. I mean, you can try to mitigate the risk and reduce the impact by getting expert advice. But then you would find out that for most people, before they get to a point where they say, oh, you know, I think I need someone, you know, they've definitely tried to venture. And then that really shapes their personal journeys. Do you understand what I'm saying? Every investor is very unique. And the only way you can find this uniqueness is to embark on your own journey. So first things first, don't be hard on yourself. You know, it's inevitable. You definitely have to make mistakes to be able to learn. And we all make mistakes. You know, it's a journey, it's a process. So that's the first thing I'd say. Second of all, I'd say you can't keep doing the same things and expecting different results. What's most important is learning from your journey, taking out those lessons, and also being more open-minded. I know it's really hard when it comes to finances to, you know, get advice from someone or let someone, you know, really take charge or to delegate. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because I mean, for everyone, it's money is quite important. Do you understand what I'm saying? I would say learn from your mistakes, learn from the journey, see how that really shapes you, because that's what makes you who you are, and that's what really sets the precedent for your peculiar attributes as an investor. You know, some people would say, oh, I got burned doing this, so I don't want to do this way. Some people would say, oh, this worked out for me, you know. So that's what really makes you who you are. So I think you have to be really sensitive and make sure that you're taking notes at every point in time. And then you let that shape who you are and who you're going to be moving forward. And then once you get to that point, then you can start to seek the right people that you feel like are the right fit for you, for your unique goals and unique aspirations as an investor.
That was really good. Thank you for that. So can you tell our listeners a little bit about your story, how you came to where you are today?
Sorry, I lost you for a second.
Oh, I'm sorry. Can you hear me now?
Yes, loud and clear. Yeah.
Okay. I was telling her a little bit about your story, how you came from Mobile Code Room all the way to Flovel, where you are today.
I mean, I reckon I gave some sort of background earlier. You know, I studied finance undergrad. And at, you know, I had other interests, so I just really from the start really found a way to you know, incorporate my experience and my qualifications with you know, what I had around me, the people I had around me, what was closest to me, what I was familiar with, and that was media, entertainment, sports. That's what I really enjoyed. So I started on that journey, set up a couple of businesses, at the same time, you know, with have some sort of corporate job to, you know, just balance it out. And that's why I've been able to navigate several industries because I started working quite early. You know, I would move from industry to industry because I would say I identified the importance of evolving quite early. You know, so for me, it was always a situation whereby I was focused on the long game, you know. So if I was somewhere, I was trying to leverage off the network of the industry, the network of wherever I was working, whatever peculiarities, whatever opportunities it would avail me, and how I could leverage that to grow my personal brand. and to also just grow my my experience and my knowledge over time. So from doing that, by the time I got to my mid-20s, I decided to go back into entrepreneurship full-time. And that's when I started Mobile Cold Room. At the time, it was more necessity focused for me. I was able to spot the gaps in the market. And it was more agriculture, more agro technology, you know, things that I wouldn't necessarily have leaned towards. But then, like I said, it was more necessity focused. It was me just as an entrepreneur being able to spot what the market needed. And I ventured into that. I did that for a few years, gained some more qualification. And then I went into governance, just really from like an impact-based perspective and just for more a need for personal fulfillment at the time. So this all just ties back to evolving as a person and just paying attention to where you are mentally and what really makes you happy. I would say, you know, we talk about business, we talk about all these things, but what's most important is the human element. We're all human beings first. And I think that really ties into what we're doing professionally. You know, so that's really something that's really guided my journey over time, just how I feel, where my head is at. What I'm most passionate about at the time, and then I would more or less follow that. So I did governance, eventually Mobile Cold Room, we sold to another company in the industry. And then, you know, that's when I decided to do a 360 and reevaluate where I am and what I want to do. And, you know, right now in my career, I reckoned I wanted to do something that I was passionate about, something that, you know, would help me combine all this experience so it doesn't waste. You know, I tell people all the time, your experiences, your background, your qualifications, your mistakes, all these things is what makes you who you are. You know, that's what really sets you apart from everyone else. You know, that's all you have, you know, and that's what makes your unique story. That's what gives you a unique value proposition that you can offer your clientele. So, you know, that's just where I am right now, just combining everything at, you know, offering that to the unique clientele we're looking to work with.
That's super interesting because I literally just was talking to my mentees about things like that, because you have to be authentic, you have to be consistent, and a lot of times they wonder if aren't converting or what likes or the responses or the engagement that they think that it needs, but it's because you went to a networking mixer, didn't network, went into an engagement, and it doesn't feel authentic when you're just going up to somebody handing them this card versus getting to know someone at the event, seeing how you can either collaborate, work together. This might be your next business partner, business bestie, your next client, you might be their client, right? So just having not just having those expectations, but having a strategy on when you're invited into certain rooms and what you're looking to do. So even when you were at a job, you knew that you wanted to be an entrepreneur. So you set a plan in place. You made your job your first investor. You took your experiences from each setting that you were in and came up to where you are today. So I want to encourage anybody that's listening to make sure that you're using skills, your individuality, authenticity, your authority to market and leverage your personal brand. Can you kind of talk about the merchandising and product licensing aspect of the business?
So I'm just going to talk about that's one of the many services that we're looking to offer. First things first, I think it's important I mention that. We've got so many other services, such as investment strategies, you know, wealth management, asset management. But I'm not surprised that you're asking about this one in particular. I think it's one that really strikes interest across board. And it's one that always comes up when I have conversations about the company. Are you there? Okay, I thought I lost you for a second.
No, I'm here. We're good.
Okay. So, for Florville in particular, the merchandising is tailored to our primary clientele, as I've mentioned earlier. It's a situation whereby we know that people in this industry primarily have the reach, primarily have the influence. They primarily have the avenues to reach out to potential customers. But then you find out that there's a gap between people like established athletes, global superstars in the entertainment industry, creative professionals that have some sort of loyal following. You find out there's a gap between whatever they're doing and the potential to set up successful businesses. And then for the layman, you think, why is this person not doing this or doing that or thinking about doing this? But to be high performing, to be at the top of the pinnacle of this industries, it's a situation whereby you have to primarily focus on your craft. Do you understand what I'm saying? Things like music,
Absolutely, I understand.
art, sports. You have to, to be a top performer in this industry, you have to be totally dedicated to the craft, to the sport, to the performance. But then in the same breath, you're racking up all this influence and all these numbers and this fans and this followers, so it's quite unfortunate. But that's where we come in. We're looking to bridge the gap between these people and their fans and the followers and the influence and the reach they have, and develop some sort of commercial value that's able to bridge that gap. A lot of people have the potential to start certain products. They have the potential to start businesses outside the industry. And like I said earlier, there's no avenue to do this. So we come in, we have end-to-end business solutions. We find the right product, the right services for whoever we're dealing with. And then we do the end-to-end, from the research and development to the design to the product development to manufacturing to supply to distribution to sales and marketing, so on and so forth. I mean, I'll be honest with you, like for me as a businessman, if I'm gonna start a product from scratch, I'm gonna have to do sales and marketing. Chances are while I'm developing the product, I have zero clientele. But if I was dealing with an athlete that has access to maybe even 30 million people online, 1% of 30 million people is 300,000 people. And 1% is the most generous estimate you can ever give in a pitch. Do you understand where I'm coming from? So, just really being able to identify that and tilt more towards that and say, why don't we collaborate? We have the business expertise, we have the manufacturing prowess, we have, supply chain operational prowess. Why don't we just take this up for you, do it end to end, stick to our part of the bargain, leverage your brand equity, leverage your brand influence, and, just make a dream team, towards developing a successful brand, a product, or whatever it might be. And the same goes for product licensing. There's so many companies out there, they want to start new products, they want to diversify. Instead of starting from scratch, we can really just bridge the gap, find a way to find the right fit for the product. Same thing with endorsements, same thing with brand ambassadorships, corporate partnerships, and so on and so forth. So for us, that's the gap that we're able to identify. Obviously, it's more than identifying the gap. We've had to build, we've been working on this venture for over a couple of years. We've worked in the background. We've worked with some of these people over time, over the past decade, providing business advice personally. I mean, I started from the industry, so I have so many friends, I had so many partners, alliances. We've done business over time before deciding to venture into this and make it a corporate entity. Just really being able to, manage all this and then just, bring it to reality has been quite exciting, and we're very thankful for it.
Well, congratulations. And can you let everybody know how to get in contact with you or follow you if they would like to work with you?
As Flavel, on most social media platforms is either Flowville Consulting, I believe. On Instagram, it's Flowville Consulting. LinkedIn, on Twitter. My personal Instagram is my full name. It's OPEOLUWARUN. It's the first three letters of my last name. So you can always reach out to me. I can't promise to respond to messages immediately, but I definitely try to get to them as soon as I possibly can. You know, answer questions, give advice. I look forward to everyone also growing, you know, finding their purpose, finding their unique standpoints, and, you know, being able to offer value to the clientele and to the world in general.
You did. You came in and you provided so much value. I'm excited to share this episode with our listeners, my mentees, and also put it out to our email list. So I will get in contact with you following the episode and let you know with some more instructions on how to get this episode out there to your community, your listeners, and your potential clients as well. Thank you again for coming on to Kama Convos Podcast.
Thank you so much. Thank
to everybody you. Listening Very out so there, we always end the show with letting y'all know I want to see y'all on in there. Mothi, shout out to our sponsors, Carter Capital, Drika and Carter, the brand. And everybody that makes everything possible here.
Can I give a shout out to my PR team as well?
Absolutely.
Yes. My PR team, they've been very amazing. In all honesty, I'm a very private person, so I can never do anything like this on my own by myself. So on my PR team, Interdependence, they've been quite great. You know, working with them all the time has been quite exciting. And they're actually the one that facilitate, you know, most of the things. I get on to like this.
They did a great job. Thank you so much. I'm so glad that we connected, and I'm glad to have you on my platform. If you ever, you know, have another offer that you want to share with us or come on for a second time, the door is always open.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Well done with the great job you're doing with your mentor. And I hope it continues to go amazing. I definitely look forward to hearing more great things and more achievements from your camp as well.
Thank you. You have a great day. Happy Wednesday, y'all. As always, I want to see y'all winning and wealthy, and y'all have a great day.